Good evening, everyone. And I thank the IMU members for inviting me to this talk. It's a great pleasure being here. Cardiovascular disease, all of us know that it is in a rising trend in India. Death is inevitable, but premature death is not. So the risk factor prevalence is increasing, and all of us are aware of the fact that the cardiovascular mortality and morbidity is going to be on the rise. We need to do something to prevent this. It's very important. Earlier on, some strategy is done to prevent the rise in prevalence of CVD. In India, the public health estimates that 60% of the world's heart disease exists, despite having less than 20% of the world population. Heart disease is number one cause of mortality and silent epidemic among Indians. When you see the disease burden, more than 53% is contributed by the chronic non-communicable diseases, and 24% of which is because of the cardiovascular disease. Two-thirds of non-communicable disease is due to cardiovascular disease, and 80% of the cardiovascular death is because of the coronary artery disease and the stroke. It is estimated by the Global Burden Disease Study that the CVD death rate is around 272 per 100,000 in India, and compared to the global figure of 235 by 100,000 number, we clearly know that we have a great burden in India. CVD is prevalent in all parts of India to be increasing risk factor. Throughout India, heterogeneity of population is there. Even then, throughout India, we see a lot of CVD mortality and morbidity. The risk factor changes. In South India, we see a lot of diabetics, and in northwestern region, a lot of hypertensive patients are there. This also clearly shows that the prevalence of cardiovascular disease is increasing. In 2005, ischemic heart disease was number one, and even in 2016, the ranking remains the same, with 53% increase between this period. The cause of premature death also is number one in ischemic heart disease in 2016, a 41.5% increase, which was third place in 2005. What is special for Indians is, in Indians we see cardiovascular disease at an early age. Before 70 years of age, only 23% of Western population is affected, but in India it is 52%. High case fatality rate, which may be due to the biological mechanism, social determinants or their interactions, and greater severity of the disease. We see three vessel disease in young people in India. This also shows how the younger population in our country is affected. 50% of the heart attacks occurs before the age of 50, and 25% of the heart attacks occurs before the age of 40 in India. And it is not a sudden onset. The process starts from the risk factors, which leads to uncontrolled risk factors, leads to endothelial dysfunction, atherosclerosis, and coronary artery disease. Once coronary artery disease is established, then slowly remodeling happens, ventricular dilatation, which leads to congestive heart failure. So if we want to prevent this ladder, we have to control the risk factors. The risk factors of CVD are dyslipidemia, smoking, diabetes, hypertension, obesity, psychological stresses, lack of fruits and vegetable intake, lack of exercise, and excessive intake of alcohol. So, coming to the burden summary, the dramatic increase of CVD in the last 20 years in India, throughout India it is existent in spite of heterogeneity of risk factors, younger age group is affected, high case fatality, greater severity of disease, and primary prevention strategies are essential to reduce the problem. This is the pathophysiology of CVD. Going through it quickly, first, the normal artery at younger age with elevated cholesterol levels, atherosclerotic plaques form, and a vulnerable plaque when it breaks, platelet aggregation happens, which leads to clotting cascade being activated, leads to thrombosis, which leads to atherothrombotic process leading to stroke and coronary artery disease. Unfortunately, for healthcare providers and their patients, most prefer prescription of pills to prescription of harmful lifestyle. It's very difficult for the patient to sustain a healthy lifestyle. Even when medications are prescribed, it is very important to counsel the patient about the importance of lifestyle. So, what are all the strategies available? One is statin. What is the evidence for statin use in the primary prevention of CV? Dyslipidemia is the foremost risk factor for atherosclerosis. Diet rich in saturated fat and low BUFA contributes to it. HDL cholesterol is cardioprotective and LDL and VLDL are atherogenic. It's important that LDL is necessary and sufficient for atherosclerosis. Necessary in the sense without elevation of LDL, the risk of cardiovascular disease is less, and it is sufficient even when other risk factors are all not there. Presence of LDL elevation itself can lead to atherosclerosis. In beta-hypobetalipoproteinemia, which is a genetic condition, actually these patients, even in spite of having other risk factors, are protected from CVD and major adverse coronary events. Non-HDL cholesterol is a strong predictor of severity of CAD and MACE. So, how do we control the cholesterol levels? First line of treatment for the CVD morbidity and mortality is statin treatment. It reduces all-cause mortality, major adverse cardiovascular events, need for coronary artery reperfusion procedures, as well as the stroke production. How it acts is by HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor reduces the synthesis of cholesterol. Relationship between cholesterol level and the CVD risk is continuous, and benefit at all levels of CVD risk happens. It is effective in halting the progression and reversing the atherosclerosis if the LDL level is kept less than 70. This is the meta-analysis of the statin outcome trials for primary prevention. It clearly shows a much higher benefit in controlling the non-fatal cardiovascular events, in all-cause mortality, in fatal stroke, and in non-fatal strokes. The Jupiter trial clearly shows that the rosuvastatin in actually primary prevention helps in reducing the primary endpoint of fatal and non-fatal cardiac as well as the coronary artery disease. Even when the risk of coronary artery disease is low, statin is known to be beneficial. Even if the annual risk is less than 1%, there is 43% risk reduction, 6 MACE per 1000 is prevented, and number to treat is 167. The annual risk of 1 to 2%, there is 36% risk reduction, 15 MACE per 1000 population, number needed to treat is 67. There is no excess risk of non-vascular mortality, and benefit outweighs the possible hazard. So these are the classification of cholesterol, which I don't want to go into it. The LDL and non-HDL goal, in high-risk population, the LDL goal is less than 100 and non-HDL less than 130, usually 30 milligrams higher than the LDL goal. When the risk factor is moderate, then the LDL should be kept less than 130 and non-HDL less than 160. And if there is low risk, then LDL to be kept less than 160 and non-HDL to less than 190. Triglycerides are also important in reducing the atherogenesis. Less than 150 is normal, 150 to 199 is borderline high, and 200 to 499 is high, and more than 500 is very high. Usually, pharmacological treatment is reserved for people who have very high level of triglycerides, more than 500, to reduce the risk of pancreatitis. And primary goal is to reduce the LDL. And after the reduction of LDL and with lifestyle modification, if the triglyceride is not under target, then additional non-statin therapy is needed to reduce the triglyceride levels. So it's very important to impress upon the patient, even when the statin is prescribed, to follow a lifestyle which is very important to control the risk. Weight management, increased physical activity, and dietary modifications are important. This is the chart which shows which statin and how much to use. If we want a reduction of more than 50% of LDL, then rosuvastatin of 40 mg will help, or atorvastatin of 80 mg, and depending on the percentage reduction needed, the type and in dosage of the statin to be decided. Again, the same chart showing high intensity lowers the LDL to more than or equal to 50%, which is actually rosuvastatin 20 and 40 milligram, and moderate intensity reduces the LDL between 30 to 50%, which is rosuvastatin of 5 milligram and 10 milligram. And the atorvastatin high intensity is 40 and 80 milligram, and moderate intensity is 10 and 20 milligram. And rosuvastatin is the, and atorvastatin is the most frequently used statins in our country. This is the algorithm from the American College of Cardiology, where for primary prevention, it's important to follow this to know which patient will benefit from the statin treatment. So, if the patient is diabetic and the age of the patient is between 40 to 75 years, or if the LDL is more than 190, it is very highly recommended that the patient is started on statin. After discussing with the patient the risk-benefit of the treatment, adverse effects, drug-drug interaction, and patient preference, and after starting the statin and monitoring is necessary. If there is no diabetes, age is between 40 to 75 years, and LDL cholesterol is between 70 to 189, then 10-year risk of cardiovascular disease to be ascertained. And if the risk is high, it is prudent to start on statin. And if the risk is moderate, it is at the discretion of the individual assessment of the patient should help in treatment. If the risk is low, and if the age of the patient is less than 40 and more than 75, and LDL cholesterol is 190, then it is usually very, depending on the other risk factors, it is better to decide on the treatment. Apart from lipid lowering property, statin has other effects which helps in reducing the cardiovascular risk. Reduces the platelet aggregation and thrombus formation, improves fibrinolytic profile, lowers the inflammation and the CRP, reduces the risk of venous thromboembolism, reduces atrial and ventricular arrhythmia, 77% secondary prevention and 40% of new onset, and reduces the risk of gallstones and cholecystectomy. Adverse effect of statin is more safe. The hepatotoxicity is very rare, and some amount of elevation in the transaminases can happen, but monitoring is necessary. If there is more than 3 times the upper limit of normal elevation in liver enzymes, then the statin therapy should be stopped. And the risk increases in alcoholics, otherwise the safe and monitoring itself is sufficient. The risk of hemorrhagic stroke is less with 0.5% per 1,000 patients over 5 years. Then myopathy is more frequent side effect encountered clinically. More often it is fatigue and some amount of body pain. But if the creatinine kinase level is not elevated, not too much elevated, less than 3 times, and the symptom is manageable, we can continue with the statin. Atorvastatin is least in causing myopathy, and patients can be switched over to atorvastatin with lesser dosage, which is tolerated, to benefit the patient. Cognitive impairment and peripheral neuropathy are not being demonstrated in any randomized controlled trials. Few observational studies have shown, but the risk is not much. New onset diabetes. This is one thing which came after the Jupiter trial. There's 9% increase with 1 per 255 patient treated, but greater CVD event reduction happens even when a patient becomes a diabetic. So it is very important that for this reason, the statin should not be held, and the chance of becoming a new onset diabetic increases only in patients who have the risk factors, like if they are obese, if the fasting blood sugar is more than 100, or if they have metabolic syndrome. Cancer, there is no risk with statin. So the United States Preventive Service Task Force recommendation for high risk patient, it is D level recommendation, and for moderate risk patient, it is C level. What is the role of aspirin in primary prevention of CVD? The statin prevents the atherosclerosis and it causes regression over time. But aspirin helps in preventing the acute event that happens with the rupture of the plaque. Aspirin is a cyclooxygenase inhibitor which binds to the hormone enzyme, and what happens is it blocks the production of thrombocyte A2, which reduces the platelet aggregation, and it's a potent vasoconstrictor, and in that way it helps in preventing the thrombus from forming. These are the secondary prevention trial. There is absolutely good benefit with aspirin after a CVD event. But for the primary prevention, earlier in 2002, with anti-thrombotic trialist collaboration studies, it was actually endorsed for use of aspirin in everyone by the United States Preventive Service Task Force, based on the physician health study, which showed a 44% reduction, and other few randomized studies which show a benefit. But in 2009, actually reanalyzing the data, they found that there is only moderate reduction of 12% with aspirin usage, and there was increased risk of bleeding in patients. And benefit of aspirin, when they analyzed section wise in age, the greater reduction was there with elderly patients, but the increased risk of bleeding was also there. There was no gender difference, but in women's health study, elderly women had stroke protection better than others, and there's no difference with diabetes. The risk of aspirin therapy, GI bleed is increased 2 to 3 fold, intracranial bleed 0.01% per year, and extracranial bleed 0.03% per year. No net protection on stroke or vascular mortality. With 10,000 men taking aspirin who are in the ages of 50 to 59 years and have 10% risk of CVD, 225 non-fatal MIs, 84 ischemic strokes, and 139 colorectal cancers would be prevented, with 284 serious GI bleeds and 23 hemorrhagic strokes caused. In women of same age, significantly less non-fatal MIs would be prevented, but with a greater reduction in ischemic stroke, comparable CRC prevented, and with a similar number of serious GI bleeds and hemorrhagic stroke created. So this clearly shows that the more or less the number of people protected is same as number of people who are affected by the side effects of aspirin. So the guideline says that in people between 50 to 59 years with a more than 10% risk, it is B-level recommendation, and 60 to 69 years with 10% risk in 10 years of CVD risk, it is C-level. These are all the ongoing trials on primary prevention on aspirin, the results of which will help us in clearly seeing which patients will benefit. Coming to the benefit and risk of aspirin versus statin therapy in primary prevention. So in statin, there is 44% reduction in major adverse cardiovascular event. Aspirin, it is only 12% reduction. There is 4-fold increase in benefit with statin. In absolute risk reduction, statin, it is only 0.59 per 100% years, and aspirin, it is 0.07 per 100% years. 8 times higher protection with statin. So in summary, statin is the first line for primary prevention of CVD, and aspirin is reserved for high-risk individuals. Thank you.
One question. This statin mainly reduce the what kind of cholesterol? Clofib rate reduce the what kind of cholesterol? I mean, what is the
high intensity statins, at the dose of atorvastatin 80 milligram and rosuvastatin 40 milligram, reduces the LDL cholesterol as well as the triglycerides.
But then mainly reduce the LDL, right?
Mostly reduce the LDL, but it has been shown that with dietary modification of reducing the carbohydrate intake, because triglycerides is mainly produced from fat and carbohydrate. People who are not diabetic, when they have cholesterol levels, they may not be controlling the portion sizes. Main contribution is from the carbohydrate. If dietary restriction is there, and no excess alcohol intake is there, along with statin, some amount of reduction in triglycerides happens. So initially it is better to start with statin, see the response with lifestyle and statin, and then start on fenofibrate if necessary, because adding a fenofibrate increases the risk of myopathy and other side effects. And it increases polylithiasis and polycystectomy rates with fenofibrate.
But doctor prescribed the fenofibrate in the first line.
Not necessary, only above 500 for prevention of pancreatitis, treatment of triglyceride is immediate necessity.
The routine prescription of statins. The routine prescription of statins. The routine prescription of statins by your cardiologist gives a sort of a sleepy mood in our patients. They feel they can do anything taking a diabetes diet. Very unfortunately, the situation should be fought against. The first thing is to reduce the risk factors by the non-pharmacological methods. Unless that is achieved, the full potential of a statin therapy cannot be achieved. I have one comment. The Indian lipidology group have defined the values that they can overlap. LDL, VLDL, the slightly defined lower level, incidentally headed by one of our own physicians, Dr. Nursing and of North Metris. Second, I want to ask one simple question. Do you believe in intermittent statin therapy, if for 1 month, interval for 2 months, give for 1 month, interval for 2 months.
I have not come across intermittent therapy, but a lot of people are using alternate day therapy for statin. But intermittent therapy, 1 month giving statin and next month not statin, whether the control of cholesterol levels will be there, because it acts by HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor, and usually the patients are not going to be having any symptoms because of that. We won't be having a watch or monitoring the patient every day to see how their cholesterol levels are. So better to lower the dose and continue with the treatment and use them the discipline to take the medications also. That is my personal view, sir.
Some of the cardiologists emphatically state even when the cholesterol has come down to less than 100, LDL has come down to less than 50, they say take statin.
Lifelong.
Lifelong.
Yes.
Very strongly I oppose this view. When you have reached a target level, you have set a target level for the population. You have reached that target level. After reaching the target level, there is no sense at all in continuing the therapy. That is why I strongly believe in intermittent therapy. So that monitor thing. Of course, opinions differ and both opinions are accepted, sir.
It's always a controversial issue. The thing is, when you are starting the patient on a statin, there are two views. One is, you set a target. You set a target for different types of people with different risk factors. So, the HOPE-3 trial has clearly demonstrated that you don't need to set a target. It is not target oriented, and the statins, not by reducing the cholesterol, because of its pleiotropic action, especially its calming effect on the plaque, it prevents or it reduces the risk for plaque rupture, which is the initial stage for the formation of an acute aneurysm. There is one point. So if you start a patient on a statin, statin has to be continued lifelong. Starting a statin and stopping it, it involves higher risk than not starting statin at all. Either you don't want, if you don't want to give statin, don't give it at all. But if you have a belief that statin will help the patient, if you start that, you have to continue it for forever. And the second thing is, the need for continuous monitoring of the liver enzymes that is now given. You start the patient on statins. After one time, you estimate the liver enzymes, or at the time of starting, you estimate the liver enzymes, and after 1 month, you again examine the enzymes are not elevated, very unlikely that the enzymes will be elevated in future. So there is no need for a continuous monitoring of liver enzymes. If the enzymes are elevated, there is one drug that is available, pitavastatin, in place of rosuvastatin. And about the triglycerides, any triglyceride levels more than 500, it calls for an imminent reduction in the triglyceride level because it produces pancreatitis. Fibrostatin, the fenofibrate is the first drug of choice to reduce the triglycerides and bring it down below 500. Once it comes below 500, then you start the patient on atorvastatin. Again, because the myopathy. And the Jupiter trial, I think it is done by the financial commitment from AstraZeneca. So what happens? The AstraZeneca people, somehow they convinced the FDA that this drug is very safe. So that drug was released into the market even before the safety of the drug is established. When the drug was imported to India, they said, you give half the dose. For Americans, if it is 40 milligram, for Indians, you give 20 milligram. There is no trial conducted on the Indian population and especially the Asian populations. And the AstraZeneca ended up paying a huge amount as a compensation to the USA government because of this. Then to circumvent that, they conducted a small trial involving a small group of people and they said, this is a very safe drug. Actually, rosuvastatin, it carries a high risk of myopathy and renal
failure.
No, fenofibrate. Don't start with combination. Fenofibrate. Fenofibrate, once it reaches the level of 500, then you can either combine fenofibrate and statin or glucostatin. The idea is triglycerides does have a role in producing atherosclerosis, but its role is very minimal. But it can produce an immediate pancreatitis. So the purpose is to reduce the risk for pancreatitis. You give fenofibrate and bring it down to less than 500. Once that goal is achieved, then you can combine the glucostatin.
I request Dr. Subramani, please come forward and hand over the certificate of his